have a memory.
Sounds good. Okay. All right, a few more joining. And again, we're going to be having a kanpai in the beginning of the event, so please get your sake ready and glasses. If you are already starting, that's sorry, fine. Let's enjoy this event together. I see everyone raising your glasses. I'm behind. Awesome. It'll be nice if you can comment what you're drinking right now. Right, by the way, I am going to have tokubetsu junmai. Ooh.
Same one, the tokubetsu junmai.
Awesome.
All right.
Kanpai.
Yes, and if anybody is also has sparkling, I'm going to pour the sparkling first and do my cheers with that. So if anyone wants to join me with sparkling, please do. But you can enjoy sparkling anytime tonight as well. But I have chosen to get started with that one.
The sparkling, yeah. No. I didn't order that though. Sparkling, sorry.
All right. So it's a 5 o'clock, so I guess we can get started, Timothy, is that okay?
Yeah, that's great.
All right, okay, thank you again, everyone, for joining tonight. I'm super excited. My name is Mimi from Tipsy. Tonight, we are so lucky to have Timothy with us. Yay, Timothy! So just to give you a little bit of introduction about him, so Timothy is a sake samurai. He's been an amazing friend to Tipsy, but so he was given the title of sake samurai by the Japan Sake Brewers Association Junior Council, which is a truly honorable title that only a few sake experts are selected for. And he is also a founder of Urban Sake, and it's a website, and I personally regard it as a Wikipedia of Japanese sake. So if you haven't been there, please, please visit when you have a chance. I will share the link in the chat. Here you go. So yeah, so that's another thing about him. And lastly, but not least, he's a global ambassador for Hakkai-san. So that's why he's here hosting our, you know, Hakkai-san virtual sake tasting event tonight. And please take this advantage to learn from him. So, okay, I'm so excited. I know everyone's excited to learn a lot from him tonight. Okay, and before we move to the presentation, let's have a kanpai.
Oh yeah.
You guys all have glasses ready? Okay, great. So I'm going to be taking group photo. So please keep your smile. All right, oh, thank you. All right, 3, 2, 1, kanpai.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Cheers.
One more time. Goodbye. Thank you.
Cheers.
All right. Perfect. Thank you so much. So are you all ready?
Oh. Yeah.
All right. Let's get started then.
Okay. Thank you, Mimi. Thank you so much. It is such a pleasure to be here with all of you guys tonight, drinking some Hakkai-san and talking about sake. I am really excited, and I thought I might start by doing just a brief self-introduction and giving you some background on myself. So my name again is Timothy Sullivan, and I am a sake samurai and a global ambassador for Hakkai-san Sake Brewery. I represent them around the world, but not only do I go around and introduce their sake and educate about Hakkai-san, but I also lived at the brewery for 1 year, and I had a 12-month internship in 2017, making sake, living at the brewery. So I have a really great insider's view of the way this sake is made and what this brand is all about. And I have some pictures to share with you later that show you a little bit behind the scenes of making sake at Hakkai-san. This is a really well-known brand in Japan, and I am so happy to be partnered with them. And I'm very passionate about the Niigata region, and about the Hakkaisan brand. So I wanted to start out tonight by doing a little poll, and I just want to find out among all the guests who have joined us today, first of all, what your experience level with sake is, if we have any absolute beginners in the audience, or if you're all more established sake connoisseurs. And I also want to ask you by a poll, which of the Hakkaisan sakes you picked up for tonight. So I'll start with the first poll, which is going to ask you how much experience you have with sake. And I'm just going to launch that. You should be able to see that now. And that should pop up. Mimi, are you seeing that? Okay, great.
Yeah.
So we're going to find out as a group how much experience we have with sake. And this will help me guide the seminar a little bit if we don't have any absolute beginners in the crowd. All right, so let's see. We have a good response. Let's see where we stand here. And I'll show you the results. Okay, so we are a pretty advanced crew, 1-800-SUPER-PRO. I love it. Okay, so the majority here, we have a lot of people who drink sake regularly, and we got a good percentage who are all sake all the time, just like me. So that's wonderful. All right. And I got one more quick poll for you. Which sakes do you have on hand? And this one, you should be able to check multiple. So if you purchased multiple bottles, or you bought all of them or just one, you can let us know which sakes you've purchased for tonight, and we can see what everyone has in front of them. Oh, this is really, really interesting. Okay. I'm going to wait one more second. Okay, let's see the response here. This is really interesting, Mimi. This is evenly split.
I know.
So everybody has a little bit of everything. I thought one sake might be a little bit more purchased than the others, but it looks like we have a broad selection, so we can spend time on each and every one of the Hakkaisan sakes tonight. This is fantastic. All right. And let's share the results here so everyone can see. Yeah, so everybody purchased across the whole spectrum. That's really fantastic. All right. Excellent. Now, as we go through, I'm going to be talking a little bit about the area where Hakkaisan is located, a little bit about sake classifications and about the production method. And I'm going to show you some scenes behind, I'm going to show you some shots behind the scenes at the sake brewery. And if you have any questions as we're going along, feel free to unmute yourself and just shout out with your question at any time. I'm happy to keep this very conversational. I'd love to hear your questions in real time. But if you're not comfortable, please put a question in the chat and I'll ask Mimi, I know she will, to keep her eye on the chat. And if any questions come in, Mimi, please interrupt me at any time. Even I can get very passionate and go on and on and on about sake all night. So it's your job to interrupt me.
Got it.
All right. So let's start. If you'll allow me, I want to just share my screen. And I'm going to introduce you, first of all, to the region where Hakkaisan is located. And again, I had the great pleasure and privilege to live there for 1 year. And you should all be able to see my screen now. And these are the sakes we'll be talking about tonight. As you're enjoying your kanpai glass, your sip of kanpai sake, there's no particular order to taste these in. If you have all of them, the order I have them on here in the screen is kind of lightest to more rich. I'm starting with the sparkling myself, but please enjoy them in any order. Sake is all about having fun and enjoying yourself. So I am not a big fan of rules and regulations when it comes to sake too much. So let's move on to the area where Hakkaisan is located in Japan. And here you can see a map of Japan. And the area highlighted in red is Niigata Prefecture. Now, if you're familiar with sake and you know a little bit about regions, sake is really one of the most popular beverages from Niigata Prefecture. The entire country of Japan is about the size of California. So I refer to Niigata as the Napa Valley of Japan because it is a region where premium craft sake production is really concentrated. And two things that are unique about Niigata. One is that the per capita consumption of Japanese sake is the highest in Niigata. And number two, there are more sake breweries in Niigata than any other prefecture. We have about 90 sake breweries in Japan. Sorry, 90 sake breweries in Niigata. There's about 1,300 in Japan. So there's a high concentration of consumption, a high concentration of production, and it was a wonderful place to live and study sake. Now, if we look at the topography of Niigata, the black star here is where our brewery is located. And you can see there's towards the Sea of Japan here, towards the water, there's these vast plains. But if you go to the eastern edge of the prefecture, there's all these mountains. And the mountains are almost like a backbone, a spine down the eastern edge of Niigata. And this is a really very important geographical feature to Niigata. It has a tremendous impact on the weather and the sake. So what happens with these mountains on the far east of this prefecture? We get Arctic air coming from Siberia over the Sea of Japan. It picks up a lot of moisture. And the first thing it hits is the mountains of the eastern border of Niigata. This causes snow to be dumped on the western side of those mountains. So everything west of that mountain range gets absolutely covered in snow. And you can see that Hakkai-san, our little black star here, is right in the crosshairs of that. So one of the things that people think of when they think of the Niigata region is snow. And this is a picture of the brewery. This is one of the buildings at the brewery the year I lived there. And this was a typical January day. You can see the snow can get very, very deep, 5, 6, or even 7 feet on the ground at any one time. And that snow is really integral to the style of sake. I'll talk more about that in a minute. Now, the brand name of our sake is Hakkai-san. And Hakkai-san in English means eight peaks or eight-peaked mountain. And this is a picture of the beautiful mountain that is a 5-minute drive from our brewery. And if you can't see the peaks, I'm going to point them out to you right there. So those are the eight peaks of Hakkai-san, the eight-peaked mountain. So our brewery is literally in the shadow of this mountain. And not only are we geographically close to the mountain, but also our water source is at the foot of this mountain. So we use 100% Niigata heavy snow melt mountain stream water to make our sake. And there is a stream that we collect all of our water from right at the foot of this mountain. And that is why the brand is named after this local mountain. It's our water source, and it is the highest peak in the area. And here is a winter view of Hakkai-san Mountain. It's absolutely beautiful there in the winter. And this is a photo I took of the guest house. So if you come and stay with us at Hakkai-san Brewery, this is where you'll be put up. It's a 100-year-old ryokan or a Japanese inn that we use for guests to the brewery. And this was, again, just a typical January day in the depths of the winter, just to show you how crazy the snow gets there. Now, before we move on to sake ingredients and stuff like that, I wanted to show you one more picture. And I often say in my seminars that sake is not just liquid in a bottle. Sake is not just something you drink. Sake is also the people that make it. And I wanted to introduce you to our Toji. This is Mr. Nagamo, and he's also drinking the sparkling Awa. this was at the Awa launch event in New York. Mr. Nagamo is our master brewer. Again, we call that a Toji. And this is on a rooftop in Times Square at a hotel when we did a launch party. And he wore his kimono. And this is the mastermind behind the taste and direction of Hakkai-san. And I just wanted you to see Mr. Nagamo and know that there are so many dedicated brewers at the brewery who are working so hard to bring you delicious sakes at Hakkai-san and at all the Japanese sake brewers. All right. So that's a little introduction to the region and a little bit about the brand. Does anyone have any questions?
I do.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Is there information on the website about staying at the facility?
If you're interested in staying at the facility, it's not generally open to the public. But they do have the facility you can visit. There is a, well, first of all, unfortunately, even if we could, the tourist visas are not open right now. So Japan is not open to foreign visits at the moment anyway.
Right.
So we're already at a disadvantage there.
In a normal time.
Yeah, in a normal time. It needs to be prearranged in advance. So I would recommend that you contact me or contact the sake's distributor.
Okay.
And ask about visiting the brewery. There is a compound there with a soba restaurant. It's a wonderful day trip. There's lots to see around the brewery, and it's a great place to visit. It's about 90 minutes from Tokyo.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? I hope everyone is enjoying their first sake. I'm enjoying my awa very much. And I wasn't sure what order to taste these in because everyone is going to have different sakes, but I thought that it might be a good time to spread out some of the tasting notes and do a guided tasting. So since I have the awa open, I'm going to talk about this one first. And let me show you the screen that is will give us the information on the awa. Here we go. All right. So the awa, if you have it, please have a glass and take a sniff. One of the things that I love about this sparkling sake is that the aroma is very fruity and it has a little bit of sweetness when you taste it, but it's not too sweet. The finish is dry. And I know that is one of the things that the brewery really wanted to make sure about when they created this sake. The most important thing to know about the awa is what awa means. Awa means bubble or foam in Japanese. So this is just an indication whenever you see awa attached to a sake that it means sparkling sake or bubbly sake. This has a little bit lower alcohol content than some of the other sakes. The average for sake is about 15%. And this one comes in at 13%. The SMV, that's our measurement of how sweet or dry a sake is. The negative numbers tend to be a little bit sweeter and the plus numbers can be just a touch drier. This is a -5. And like I said, there's a little sweetness up front, but the finish is really crisp and clean. And I hope anyone who's trying this with me right now can verify that the finish is kind of crisp. It doesn't linger too much sweetness on the palate. The other number I like to look at, I'm a numbers nerd and a real sake nerd, so I love to look at all these stats and numbers, but the one that I think is the most important is the rice milling ratio, how much the rice is polished before brewing. And this one is polished to 50%. So that means every grain of rice used to make the Hakkaisan awa was milled to half its original size. That is the entry level to super premium quality, 50% or less remaining. Now, this sake is made in what we call the traditional, or some people say the champagne method. That means we don't inject bubbles like we're making seltzer or Coca-Cola. We do a 2-month secondary in-bottle fermentation. So this bottle, what they do is they make a clear, still sake. So they make a sake without bubbles first. It's a premium 50% milled sake, not bubbling. And then they take that clear sake, finished sake, they put it in the bottle. And then with sparkling wine, you would add some sugar and you would add some yeast, and that would kick off your secondary fermentation. But with the rules and regulations in Japanese sake, we are not allowed to add sugar. Sugar would make this not a premium sake anymore if you added sugar. It's not an allowed ingredient. So what we add to create the bubbles is we add fermentation mash from a second batch. So we have a second batch of sake that's still in the fermentation stage. And we take some of that Moromi mash or that fermentation mash that goes in the bottle with the finished sake. We seal it up and it gets a secondary fermentation for 2 months. So that creates an all natural sparkle and a very, very fine bubble. If you have it in your champagne glass or your wine glass, you can see that the bubble is very small and very fine. And that is difficult to achieve when you're doing CO2 injection. So getting the secondary bottle fermentation is the way to create a very, very fine product. And I love this sparkling. We sent out an email about a few pairing ideas for this. I love to have this on its own, just as I am right now, as an aperitif. I love to use it to awaken my palate, have it as a starting sake to kick off the evening. It's a wonderful way to greet guests or have sake after work. It's a wonderful sake to kind of spark your appetite for dinner coming up. If you are having it with food, there's two recommendations I have. I love to have the sake with anything from the raw bar. So if you think about crab legs, shrimp cocktail, oysters on the half shell, clams, all these things that you get at the raw bar are wonderful with this sake. And number two, I also love this sake with dessert. So if you pair this with a fruit tart or some really high quality dark shards of dark chocolate, or a dark chocolate mousse, but I really love it with fruit desserts as well because it has that little hint of lemon on the aroma.
So looks like Lisa and a few other people are having our right now.
Yeah,
so exciting. And even though Tachiko answered the question, Lisa had a question.
Yeah,
so like, you know, what would be the best temperature, you know, is it supposed to be served chill? Do you have any, you know, recommended way to enjoy this?
That's a great question. For the awa in particular, we really recommend well chilling this sake. It really brings out the crisp finish. And this is one sake you can serve really quite cold, very successfully. When you chill a bubbly sake down, it holds more of the bubbles in the liquid. The warmer the sake gets, the more gas escapes from the liquid. So chilling it down, making it really cold, allows you to open it easier as well. You get less of an aggressive pop when you open the sake that is very, very, very cold. So I like to keep it really cold, get it open. You'll have less spillover. If it's room temperature when you try to open it, you'll probably lose a little sake from overflow. So really, this sake in particular, we really recommend cold. That was a great question.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Great. Fantastic. So that's our first sake. And I think I'll move on to introduce one more, and then we'll talk about some sake classifications. So the next sake I want to introduce you to is going to be the Junmai Daiginjo. That's the one in the green bottle. Now, this is a personal favorite of mine. So Hakai-san Junmai Daiginjo. So please let us know if anyone is drinking this one right now, the Junmai Daiginjo in the green bottle. Now, this has a 15.5% alcohol percentage. The sake meter value here is +4. So we're going to look for something that is just a touch on the dry side. And I have my bottle here. So I'm going to open mine as well and have a sip with you guys. It's the least I can do. All right. Okay. Now, this uses a rice polishing rate of 45% remaining. The previous sake, the sparkling, was 50% remaining. This one mills the rice all the way down to 45% remaining. So this is a very, very luxurious treatment of the rice before brewing. And let's go ahead, and if you have this in the glass, let's give it a smell and a taste. So you should notice a very gentle aroma. This sake, of all the sakes we're going to taste tonight, this one has the most restrained and kind of quiet aroma. And sometimes when people come from the wine world and they're used to smelling wine aromas, they might say, oh, I'm not sure what I'm smelling, or, you know, I'm not picking up on much. But this is a classic style of regional Niigata sake. Light, crisp, and clean are the key words for this Junmai Daiginsho. So let's go ahead and give this a taste as well. So this sake in particular is very light in body. And the finish, just like the awa, the finish should be relatively crisp and clean here. You're not going to get a lot of lingering flavor on the palate. Now, I have a nickname for this sake that is on sake menus across the country, I found out, which is magic water. So when I first had this sake, I said it tastes light and clean like a mountain stream. It tastes like water, but there's something magical going on. So I called it magic water. And that term has been used by people to describe this sake. And I just love it whenever I hear that. It is that light, clean, and crisp. Now, when it comes to the food pairings, I love this with the classics. Having this with sushi, I know some of you are having sushi tonight with our webinar. And if you're having sushi, this is really one of the sakes I highly recommend to pair with that. There is a very light body overall and a really restrained aroma, and it lets the fish really come forward. The delicate raw fish, whether you're having sashimi or sushi, that can really shine. You know, the president of Hakkaisan described his philosophy of pairing once, and it's always stuck with me, and I really want to share it with you. He said that when I make sake, I want the chef at the restaurant to create the work of art, to do the painting. And for me, the sake that I make is going to be the frame for that painting. And I want my sake to support and put the focus on the food. I want to be there to support what the chef is doing, but not jump in center stage and not take the limelight. We want the focus to be on the food. And that description of pairing, especially for this sake, has always stuck with me. So is anyone drinking the Junmai Daiginsho right now?
Yes, quite a few people actually.
Yeah, what do you think? Any feedback for us?
Yum.
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, some people are enjoying with sushi.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm on a rainbow roll right now.
Awesome. Yeah.
So actually, I have a question from Prasad. It's actually, I guess it's regarding to awa.
Sure.
So where does sparkling sake fall in the realm of sake? Does it have the placement of champagne in wine? Interesting question.
Yeah. So sparkling sake is a new category for sake. It hasn't existed very long, so it's not a historical traditional product. And there's two kinds of sparkling sake. There's the kind we had tonight with awa, which is a champagne method or traditional method where you do the in-bottle fermentation and you get a very premium product. But there's some sparkling sakes that are made just for fun, and they are very sweet, they might be cloudy, and they inject bubbles into the sake. And they're made to be fun and less expensive. So there's kind of a high road and a more casual road for enjoying sparkling sake. I think that some brewers like Hakkaisan have decided that they really wanted to challenge themselves to make a sparkling sake that can really stand up to some very high quality sparkling wines. And the story behind the origin of Hakkaisan Awa is actually when the Olympics were first proposed to come to Japan. The president, Mr. Nagamo, he couldn't imagine a reception at the Olympics where they were doing a cheers with sparkling wine from France. So he said, I have to make a sparkling sake that lives up to that quality. And that's where awa came from. So the Olympics did not go off as expected, as we all know, but the origin story is still there. And the preparation to get to 2020 with a delicious sparkling sake was years in the making. So,
wow, that makes it very enticing. Thank you.
Yeah. I hope you're enjoying it.
I don't have it, but I've generally stayed away from sweet. My perception of it is that it's sweet.
Yeah.
And so, but I'm going to try this.
Yeah. Yeah, we can ask other people on the call if anybody is drinking the sparkling. Do you think it's like really sweet, or does it have that dry finish like I suggested? What is anyone who's drinking it now along with me? Do you think it's too sweet?
I've had it before, and yeah. So it's definitely more lined up with champagne than being sweet.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I would even go maybe as far as to say a dry finish, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, I think that's a perfect description. Yeah, it does. The fermentation time on the resting in the bottle is only 2 months. So you don't get those yeasty, toasty notes that you get with a 5-year age champagne. So it has a brighter freshness to it, but it does have a very clean finish, not too sweet. A lovely melon aroma. So it's in my book, it's a winner. So don't be afraid of too much sweetness there.
David is sharing that it's not too sweet, definitely has the dry finish that you mentioned.
Yes.
Die on the point.
That's great. So since a lot of you are more experienced sake drinkers, I thought I might walk you a little bit through the sake production process and show you some photos from my time at the brewery. So all the photos I'm going to show you feature me in a very silly looking outfit. So I know Mimi will enjoy that. So let's look at sake production before we taste our next sake. And I can just walk you through some of the production steps. And it's nice to see behind the curtain a little bit. So let me go back to here and share my screen. And all right, so you should be able to see that. So when we make sake, the first thing we have to do is polish the rice. And these are what the rice milling machines look like at Hakkai-san. The rice goes into these tall gray hoppers and then comes down. Do you see the area that's like a funnel here? Drops the rice on a millstone, which is right by this yellow block here. And the rice falls over a milling stone, gets grated a little bit, and then goes back up to the top. And that process takes about 48 hours to go from 100% grain. And taking the awa as an example, if we were making the awa, we'd need to be milling the rice in this machine for 48 hours. So it takes about 2 days to mill from 100% down to half the original size. And this is what the milling stone looks like inside. So this is inside spinning at a high speed, and the rice kind of rolls over the edge of this. And the texture on the stone is a high heat ceramic, and it feels like sandpaper. So it's just a very gentle grinding little by little of the outer layers. Now the outer layers of the rice grain contain the fats and the proteins, and we want to mill those away and isolate the starch that's in the center of the grain. And that starch we can convert to sugar and alcohol. So that rice milling is one of the key indicators of the classification or the grade of the sake. So after we mill the rice, we need to wash it. And that's me. Here I am washing the rice. And this is a way that we do the hand washing. And this is if you ever make rice at home, if you have a rice cooker and you get rice from the grocery store, Asian rice, and you want to rinse it off a few times before you put it in the rice cooker, that is exactly what we're doing here. The rice has been milled. There's a little powder on there. We want to get that off. And then after that, we do steaming. And this is the rice steamer. So at the bottom right corner here, it's called a koshiki. And it is a circular, almost looks like a giant soup can. And we layer the rice in there. Steam comes up from below. And what I'm doing here, my colleague is scooping out the steamed rice and I'm taking it over to be cooled before it goes on to the next step. So this is what the rice steamer area looks like. Then,
Timothy, yeah. Oh, sorry, before we go any further, David has a question.
Yeah.
What do they do with the leftovers of the milling process?
That's a great question. So when you're doing the rice milling, there's a lot of rice flour or powder that comes off. And in Japanese, we call that nuka, N-U-K-A. And nuka comes off in different grades and different qualities. So the outermost layer of the rice grain is brown, And that is less desirable. And the closer you get to the center, the rice powder gets whiter and whiter in color as you get towards the starchy center. So it becomes more usable for other things. The outer layer is mainly used for animal feed and just not really very interesting things. But when you get towards the center, you can use the rice powder for making rice crackers. You can use it for making cosmetics. You can use it in making sweets and candies. So there's many uses for the powder that comes off of the rice grain. So nothing goes to waste.
It's great for your face.
Oh, yeah. Right?
Oh, yeah. It's just awesome. When we go to that, the special sushi bar, right? He always gives us a bag of the rice powder.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's not something that is very valuable. The brewery can resell it, but it's just pennies on the dollar for what they paid for the actual rice, but it does not go to waste. So that's the really good thing. And all right. So we did the rice steaming. So once the rice is steamed, it's ready to be made into koji. And koji is one of the really important ingredients in sake. Koji is a type of mold that we grow onto steamed rice. And this mold gives off an enzyme that breaks down starch into sugar. So this is how we get sugar out of rice. We need sugar to make alcohol. And the Japanese mastered this method of growing a healthy, friendly mold onto rice that gives us the enzymes we need to break down starch into sugar. So what I'm doing here is I'm working in the room where we actually grow the mold onto the rice. It's called the koji muro. And in my hand is the little sachet, the little cheesecloth with the mold spores in there. And I'm sprinkling them onto the rice. And it takes about 48 hours to properly grow the mold spores onto the rice. And I want to see if I have a picture here to show you what this looks like. Yes. So this is what the koji rice looks like. So you see the little fuzzy bits that are growing on there? That's the mold spores that are starting to take hold. And we take about 20% of this molded rice and 80% regular steamed sake rice when we put together a batch of sake. So about 20% of the rice needs to go through this process that grows the mold on it. And again, the mold is going to allow us to break down the starches into sugar. Without that mold, we wouldn't get sake as we know it. So after the koji is done, this process takes about 2 days, we need to do a yeast starter. So this is where the rubber hits the road and where fermentation begins. We take a small tank, we put in regular steamed sake rice, we put in the koji rice we made, we put in water, and all the yeast goes in on the first day. And the role of yeast, if you know your wine or your beer, the role of yeast is to eat sugar and give off alcohol and CO2. So that is alcoholic fermentation at its most basic. So this yeast starter is a 2-week period where we let the fermentation start and we get a really strong, healthy yeast colony up and running. So we create an environment that lets the strong yeast survive. And it is very protected, very small, and it allows us to create a healthy yeast colony for the main tank. And that is what comes next, the main fermentation mash. And it looks like I'm just bent over a hole in the floor, but this is actually a 2-story tank system. So the tank is on the ground floor. If you go up the stairs to the first floor, the mouth of the tank is sticking through the floor. So you can access the tank without walking around any scaffolding or anything. And what I'm doing here is my colleague behind me had just stirred the tank. So he used a long pole to mix the mash. And my job, because I was the lowest person on the ladder, the lowest on the totem pole, my job was to follow him along and very carefully wipe any splashes that came up from inside the tank. If you let the splashes sit there, the yeast will die and they can fall back into the tank and give off flavors to the sake. So everything is very hygienic and very clean. And that was my job on this day, was to carefully wipe down the mouth of the tank. And then this ferments for about 30 days. So this is the main mash. And this is our main fermentation room at Hakkai-san. And then the next process was actually my favorite, which is separating the alcohol from the unfermented leftover rice. And they use a machine called a yabuta, which is a sake press, and it squeezes the mash when the fermentation is done. And what I'm doing here is I am scraping out the leftover sake kasu. So these are the lees. This is the leftover pressings from fermentation. And the reason I loved this job so much is because you cannot imagine the aroma in this room. It is a pure and very delicious sake aroma. And this leftover sake kasu is used in making all kinds of things. This is also used in cosmetics. This is used in cooking. There's all types of, you can make pickles. You can bury vegetables in this kasu and make pickles. So this is a very desirable byproduct of sake production. And I have one more picture to show you from behind the scenes, and that is this picture. This is me with my best friend at the brewery. So I did more cleaning and sanitizing than anything else in my 12 months at the brewery. And any of you who are involved with beer making or wine making, you probably know that when you're doing fermentation, the sanitation is the number one thing. And whenever my colleagues didn't know what to do with me, they handed me this black mop and they're like, okay, mopu, mopu. So the Japanese word for mopping is mopu. And I learned that on my very first day. And so if you had stopped by on any given day during my internship there, you would have seen me probably holding this mop. So that's a tour of the brewery and some steps of the production process. I hope that was interesting. Does anyone have any follow-up questions from the production process?
I don't see a question in the comments, but looks like Charlie has visited a brewery before.
Oh.
He says the sake brewery smells amazing.
They really do. And every room in the brewery has its own smell. So the room where they do the pressing is the most concentrated because the mash is literally getting squeezed and the aroma is pressed out. The fermentation room has a very soft, fruity aroma. And the koji room smells like the koji mold, which is almost like a chestnut smell. It's a little nutty and grainy, but very delicious. It does not smell bad at all. It's really wonderful aroma. Okay, so let's get to our next sake. Let's taste the Tokubetsu Honchozo next, which is in the brown bottle. So if anyone has that open and you want to taste along with us, and let me share my screen again and show you the stats for this one. All right, you should see that now. All right, so this is the sake we're gonna pour next. And let's get this open. All right. All right. Now, in Japan, at our brewery, this is our best-selling sake in the Japanese market. We sell more Tokubetsu Honchozo than any other sake. And there's a reason for that. This is a great balance between affordability and very high quality. And there's one word in the name of the sake that will indicate that, and that is tokubetsu. So tokubetsu in Japanese means special. You can think of it like a reserve edition of something. And this one is, the thing that makes it special is this rice polishing ratio. So normally, a Honchozo has a rice milling percentage of around 70% remaining. But for our special or our reserve Honchozo, we mill that all the way down to 55 remaining. So this really could sell as a much higher graded sake. But we wanted to make an affordable, very high quality, and everyday enjoyable sake. So this is...
How are you allowed to make it at a good cost, given you're milling away so much of the rice?
Yeah. The way we did that for this particular sake is we have a production facility that's dedicated to making only this sake. And we have a limit to our tank size. We don't allow any automation when it comes to stirring. So the tank size is the largest you can have and still stir the tank by hand, which is a 3-ton tank size. That means 3 tons of rice can fit inside at once, and one person can stir it by hand. So what we do is we make many, 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 many of these tanks. So we do it through volume production, but we reach the top of what I would call handcrafted production. So we strike that balance between producing a large amount of it, So we have a guaranteed supply of this sake for everyone who wants it, but we don't get into automation in a way that affects the stirring or the koji making or any of those processes. So it's a wonderful balance that the brewery struck to make the sake more affordable.
Thank you.
Yeah. So let's give this a smell and a taste. Mm. Now, if you had just had the Junmai Daiginjo, that sake is, as we said, light, clean, and crisp, and on the dry side. This one is also dry, but it has a little bit more of a roundness, and I'll tell you why. This sake is a Honjozo grade, and the other sakes have all been Junmai grades. Junmai means pure rice. That means no added alcohol. As I'm sure some of you know, anything that's called a Junmai is no added alcohol. Anything that does not have Junmai has a small amount of distilled alcohol added, very, very lightly fortified with distilled alcohol. And that's not done to make the sake boozier. That's done to create more of a round texture. And that's really what I wanted to talk about with the sake, the texture. It really coats your palate beautifully, and it has a nice dry finish to it. Really great all-purpose sake. I enjoy this sake with yakitori. I have any yakitori fans on the call, one of my favorite Japanese food. It's charcoal grilled chicken on a stick. Mimi, I see you. I see you, Mimi. You love yakitori too. It has a little smokiness, charcoal grilled chicken, so good. And it's great with this. If you're having ramen or you're having any of those standard dishes, this is an all-purpose, everyday, really delicious dry sake. So you can bring this in and pair it with so many delicious Japanese foods. It has some body, some structure, and really coats the palate. All right, and we have two more sakes to go. So I want to introduce the next one. The next one is our most affordable Hakkaisan that we have in the offering for this event. This is the Tokubetsu Junmai. So you just learned this word, Tokubetsu. This is the one that Mimi has. And Junmai, again, is our pure rice style. So this does not have any added alcohol to it. This is just the pure rice style. And the special milling rate here is 60%. Most Junmais are 75-70% remaining. This goes all the way down to 60. And if you have it, let's get that in our glass as well. Okay. I'll pour a little bit here. All right. Okay. So one of the great things about doing these types of events that focus on one producer is that you can taste different sakes from the same producer side by side. And I've found in my studies of sake, my experience learning about sake, that comparing sake side by side is one of the very best ways to learn about sake. And we have the Tokubetsu Junmai here. So let's give this one a smell. All right. So there's a very gentle rice aroma, and this has what I call a little bit of a lactic character. So lactic acid is also used in the production of sake. And what you want to look for is a little dairy note, a little hint of something that might be creamy or yogurty. It's very subtle, but it opens up a lot of doors for food pairing. I really love to pair this sake with cheese. And I mentioned this in the email that went out to customers. So if you're looking for a sake to pair with pizza, and you heard it here first, pizza and sake are really good together. This one is my go-to for pairing with pizza or any dish that has some cheese. People talk about wine and cheese all the time, but I'm telling you, sake and cheese is where it's at. It is so fantastic.
Looks like Rick is having cheese, right? Was that a cheese?
All right.
I see
it. Oh, pizza. Pizza.
Oh, pizza. Oh, that was pizza. Okay.
All right. And perfect. Rick, I know you have the Tokubetsu Junmai, so you have to do the pairing and let us know how it goes.
And Kylie is also saying that they had it with pizza and it was great.
Yay.
Awesome.
Oh, that's awesome. Fantastic. All right. So this is a very special sake. It's very affordable and very approachable, easy drinking, balanced. And if you want something a little bit more focused on the dryness and round texture, I recommend the Honjozo. But if you want something with a little bit more rice and you're down with that little bit of a lactic creamy character, I really love the Tokubetsu Junmai. All right. I want to leave some time for questions at the end. So I'm going to forge ahead and do the final introduction to the sake, which is a special one we saved for last. So those of you who picked up the snow aged in the white bottle, I want you to get a glass of that. This is a very, very special sake. We started with our super special sparkling awa, and this one is aged for 3 years. So just being aged makes it a special sake. But this is called snow aged. What does that mean? Well, at the brewery, we have a special facility that was built in 2013 called the Yukimuro. Yukimuro means snow storage cellar. And this sake in stainless steel tanks is aged in our snow storage facility for 3 years. So let me show you what the Yukimuro looks like inside. And part of my internship was working for 3 weeks at the Yukimuro. So I also worked in this facility. So this is the Yukimuro inside. You can see someone right here on the left middle who is standing. That's an adult person. So you get a sense of the scale. On the right is a giant three-story tall pile of snow. And on the left, behind this perforated wall, we have 20 stainless steel sake tanks. These are used for aging sake. Now, the cold to chill this room is coming from the snow. So think of this like a giant ice block that you put in a cooler with your six-pack and you brought it to the beach. This is like an insulated room, and we are not using any electricity, no machines, no Freon, no vibrations. It is just a giant pile of snow from our snowy, our natural resource of snow from right outside the door, and the sake. Now, why do we want to age the sake cold versus at room temperature? Well, when you age sake at room temperature, it is going to caramelize and turn brown more quickly. Has anyone ever tried an aged sake that was like, almost looked like sherry? It was darker in color. Yeah, a few of you have. So if you allow sake to age at room temperature, the sugars are going to caramelize a little bit more quickly, and you get something that looks like a sherry. It's very nutty. It's very delicious, but it's not a style that we wanted to make. So the way that you avoid that caramelization happening quickly is by aging at very, very low temperatures. So we looked back into the history of Niigata, and the snow cellar concept is something that was done before refrigeration, electrical refrigeration came to Japan. So this used to be done on a smaller scale. Villages would have one of these snow rooms, and before everyone had a refrigerator in their house, people could bring fish and vegetables and keep them cold in a room like this. Now, this is a modern large version of that, but the snow aging keeps the sake. So if you want to go ahead and pour your snow aged, I'll do the same. Okay. So again, this is the beautiful white bottle here. This is a Junmai Daiginjo Super Premium. All right. Now, if you look at the color of this, 3 year plus aged, it is still clear, not nary a hint of anything chestnut or darkly colored. And that could not be achieved without the cold temperature aging. And let's take a sip of the snow aged if you have it. Wow. So this, you get all the concentration of the amino acids in the sake. You get an umami, if you're familiar with that word. Umami is a savory, delicious Japanese flavor. Think of soy sauce, Parmesan cheese, shiitake mushrooms, that kind of meaty, savory, yummy flavor. That really comes across on the finish of this Yukimuro. That concentrated flavor is what the 3 years is all about. it really is not our usual style. You've tasted all our fresher sakes, and this one has that savory umami at the finish and a much richer body. So it is aged in an elegant Niigata way. That's the way I love to describe this sake. So is anyone drinking the Yukimuro? Any feedback on this one for us?
Actually, John and Mihoko is asking if you can show the glass again, just to see the how clear it is. I'm going to put you a spotlight, so maybe I can see you.
It's a, it's a little, my lighting is a little strange. Oh, let me stop sharing. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry, my, it's clear.
Can you guys see all right, John and Mihoko? Yeah, all right.
Yeah. Sorry, I have incandescent light, so I look a little bit yellow. It may look a little bit yellow, but it's very clear. For a sake that has been around for 3 years in a stainless steel tank, if it was room temperature, it would be noticeably yellowed. You can actually try at home. You can, you have a sake you don't like so much, put it in the back of your closet and get it out in 3 years. And you'll see, just as an experiment, how it does darken with age. That's the normal course of things. But the way that we preserve and help sake from going through that caramelization effect is by using cold temperatures. And at Hakkaisan, we wanted to use our natural resource, which was snow. You know, we don't have gold mines. We don't have oil. We don't have natural gas. We have snow. So the brewery president wanted to use the snow, harken back to the history of Niigata, and create this beautiful sake. So that's why I love to finish our tastings by tasting this sake. And I really hope you enjoy the savoriness of the finish. And for food pairings here, I really recommend a savory meat dish. I love to pair this with red meat. If you're going to a steakhouse, leave your red wine at home. You can order your porterhouse. You can order your beef tenderloin. You can order your creamed spinach. And you can have the Yukimuro in place of your red wine. It is absolutely delicious. I've had it with short ribs in the recent past. Beef short ribs, so good. So
it looks like Rick is following your guideline. And they tried it with steak and they say it's good.
All right.
Awesome. And Lisa says that it's so far their her favorite. That's awesome.
Oh, fantastic. That's great. So we have a few minutes left. Does anyone have any questions about sake in general or anything we talked about tonight or any of the sakes we tasted?
Can I ask you if you produce Nama sake, can we get it? And I know there's a lot of difficulty by the nature of what it is to distribute it, but Mimi, if you could offer more Nama sakes, I would, that's my really one of my favorites.
Oh, thank you, Eric. Yes. So again, you know, just like you mentioned, Nama sake is a bit difficult for us to, you know, maintain the quality. But we're trying to carry a bit more than usual. So we are starting from seasonal ones. Mm. So like, you know, shibori tate, like, you know, hatsibori, something like that. So yeah, so keep checking our emails. We'll definitely let you know when we have a new one.
Yeah, and Hakkaisan does make an unpasteurized sake. It's on the Tipsy website. It's out of stock right now, so we didn't feature it in this tasting, but it's called the Hakkaisan Nama Genshu. And it will be available again in the future. So when the supply chain kind of comes back into alignment again, we'll have that sake again. And I really hope you'll try it. It's a very juicy and delicious example of an unpasteurized sake. It's a little bit cleaner and maybe a touch drier than some of the other kind of juicy and fruity unpasteurized sake. So again, it's a Niigata take. It's our regional style, that kind of clean, crisp, and dry. But it's a very delicious unpasteurized sake. So when that comes back into stock, I hope you'll try that.
Great. That sounds excellent. Thank you for that. Just quickly, do you know of any, I know Niigata is right next to the Noto Hanto. Is there any, do you know any sake is made up there?
In the Noto Peninsula? Yeah. Yes, yes. There are wonderful sakes made up there. I visited one brewery called Sogen, S-O-U-G-E-N. And they only sell one sake in the States, the Jun Mai. And they are kind of, I view their style as a little bit kindred to Niigata. It's a drier, more rustic style. So you can look out for sakes from there.
Did you say Sogen?
Sogen.
Okay. So actually, it's a spoiler, but for the coming up June sake box, we have a Sogen in it.
Oh my God.
crazy.
That's a great sake. Yeah. So for Noto, that's a good brewery to look at.
Yes. So it's coming up.
Yeah.
Is there a guideline for how long to leave a bottle open? Mm-hmm. And I imagine in the fridge is the best place
or
wine cooler.
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah. So it depends on the style of sake. For example, if you have something that is a ultra premium, super premium, very, very fruity, delicate aroma, that's going to deteriorate a little bit faster. If you have the Honjozo or the Tokubetsu Junmai, those are a little more hardy. So the drier, more structured sakes, you can leave them open for 3-4 weeks, even a month, no problem. Sake is very, very hardy. And the ones that are more delicate, they're going to be fine, but you'll lose some of that nuance in the aroma. So you want to drink those as quickly as possible. And our friend, the awa, the sparkling sake, that's one and done. You want to drink that as quickly as possible.
But the white bottle?
The white bottle, that you can leave open for a long time. That's already been pre-aged. It's been pre-aged for 3 years. So leave the cap on, keep it in the fridge, just as an insurance policy. But that you can keep for a year or more and just enjoy the evolution. Yeah.
You have some for dessert.
That's theoretical. I've never tested that limit. It always gets consumed in my house, but no, you really can keep it for a long time. It's a very well-structured and pre-aged for you.
Perfect. And one last question. Is there ever a good reason to have hot, warm sake?
Yes. So thank you for bringing that up. Warm sake is, we could do a whole nother hour on the sake temperature, but one thing that I think is really important to understand is that warm sake can be absolutely delicious. You just have to find the right style to warm up. The Honjozo and the Junmai that we had, again, those little bit more dry, structured ones, not so expensive perhaps, those ones are very wonderful when you warm them up. You bring out more of the umami and the texture becomes a little bit more velvety. Not every sake is going to shine when you warm it up. The sakes that are a little bit more floral and fruity in the aroma, those you want to keep chilled. But sakes that are dry in general are great when served warm. And I know the master brewer, Mr. Nagamo, that I showed you his picture at the beginning, he drinks the Tokubetsu Honjozo warm every day. So warm sake is his jam. And if the master brewer drinks it warm, then I know it's okay to recommend it to everyone.
And how is it warmed? I mean, is it microwave warm or
What we usually do is we put it in a heat-safe carafe or a heat-safe Pyrex measuring cup or something, and you just put it in a water bath for about 3 to 4 minutes. Yeah, so water bath is really the way to go. Oh, and Rick was showing us his warmer there. Yep, there we see it. Awesome. That's a great one. Yeah, so don't recommend the microwave as much, but just a water bath. Anything that's heat-safe is going to be great for that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Question, Tim.
Yeah.
With all the different styles of sake that Hakai-san brews, what is the process? Is there like a schedule that, you know, you brew the awa first or the honjozo first, or what is the, because you're milling all the rice is different, you know, the mill ratio is different for all the different styles. So how do you keep up with what's being brewed at a certain time? And now, what's Susan, in what tank?
Now, Susan, when I tell you there is a master spreadsheet, there is a master spreadsheet. All this is planned out. Yeah. All this is planned out a year in advance. How much rice they have to buy, how much it has to be milled, what they're going to produce first, what they're going to produce second. So they don't make all these sakes through the entire brewing season. So the awa season might be from December, January only. So they have very set schedule for every day. And it is a very unbelievable organization to know that the koji's ready the day you need it to make your 15th batch of awa, and the rice is steamed to add to this batch, and they have it all planned out in advance. And it is unbelievable organization. And it is not like, oh, what do we feel like making today? No. It is super controlled and really a marvel at how planned out it is.
And it also looks like it's a huge facility. So is there like a room for each kind, or is it?
Yeah, we have three rooms where we brew sake. One is the Honjozo Brewery, which is where we have the largest amount of tanks. And then we have the main brewery, which is where we make the Junmai, the Awa, and the Yukimuro. And then we have a Kowagura Brewery, which is our micro brewery. And all our ultra premium sakes, like the Junmai Daiginjo, those are all made there. And so we have three sizes of production. Larger scale for our most affordable sakes, medium scale for the mid-range, and then small production scale for the ultra premium sakes. Yeah, and in my internship, I got a chance to work in all three. So that was one great thing about interning at Hakkai-san was, you know, I didn't just work at a brewery that had factory production and these giant machines. I got to also make these tiny batches of koji for the ultra premium sake. So it was a great, great experience. And I'm so grateful I got to work with this company. Yeah, any other questions for us? So before we go, I have one final poll. And I just wanted to ask everyone who is still on the call, which of the Hakkai-san sakes you really enjoyed tonight, unexpectedly or especially. So you can pick as many or as few as you like, but I just wanted to see if you had any special reaction to one of the sakes. What did you really, really enjoy tonight from the five that we tasted? Rick cannot pick a favorite. All right, let's see where we landed with this. This is interesting. All right, let's share the results. Okay, so nobody was left out. Everyone had a connection with every sake. And I think the snow-aged came out on top. That happens often, doesn't it, Mimi? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very popular one. Great. Oh, that's awesome. Well, thank you everyone so much for the feedback. That's really actually useful for me to know how people are enjoying the different sakes. Okay. All right.
Awesome.
So, Mimi, do you have any final remarks before we wind up, or any final questions from any guests on the call? Oh, John, Mihoko have a question.
Yeah, I have a question. I apologize. I'm more of a whiskey drinker. Why would you isolate the flavor on the 3-year aged in a stainless steel barrel as opposed to something organic, wood, or some other medium?
Yeah, well, the regional profile, that's a great question, John. The regional profile for Niigata is crisp and clean. So that's the regional style. And when we're making an aged sake, the traditional profile for aged is much more like a whiskey. It's brown, it's chocolatey, it's dark. And we wanted to make an aged sake that was more close to our regional style. So we chose to make a aged sake that comes out cleaner, clear, and concentrated umami, but we wanted to avoid that darkening. So it really depends what style you want. If you're going for an aged sake that is more earthy and sherry-like, then you're going to want a wooden cask, and you can really create some aromas and flavors that are super dark and very tobacco-y and chocolatey and really lovely, but that's not our regional style. So sure. Informed by the region, informed by what people expect from our brand, we wanted to make an aged sake that had umami, had deliciousness, but was still clean and clear.
Well, Mihoko is from Sato, so it feels local.
Yeah. Great. Well, I think there's other brands out there that do a great job with the barrel aged, but for us, it's more about clean and clear.
Yeah, makes sense. Thank you.
Sure.
Awesome. Any other questions? Any last comments? It's good.
Yeah, I just want to thank everybody so much for joining. As Mimi mentioned, I do have a website, Urban Sake, but I also do a sake podcast. It is the only sake podcast in the US, and it's called Sake Revolution. So if anyone is a podcast listener and you're interested in sake, we do a tasting every week and we talk about different topics, and it is geared towards consumers. It's not an industry podcast where we talk about all crazy industry insider stuff. It's really geared towards beginners and people who are getting started with sake. And we taste a lot of sake, so you don't have to, and you can pick the ones you like that we taste. No, I'm just joking. We have a lot of fun. It's only 30 minutes. So if you're interested in listening to a sake podcast, check it out. It's Sake Revolution again. And
I've actually used the Urban Sake before for advice on different sake. So
fantastic. Good job. Thank you so much. Excellent.
Yeah, and I left the link just in case again. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. I was just going to say there's if you want any Sake 101 infographics or charts or anything like that, I have a Sake 101 tab on the Urban Sake website. And there's a sheet on warming sake, temperatures, sake production. So if you want any basic, just 8.5 by 11 sheets, you can get all of those there. Some of the things I shared in the presentation tonight, it's all free for download. And and of course, if you want to try any of the sakes from Hakkaisan you couldn't tonight, they're all available on Tipsy. And we love Tipsy so much. We appreciate working with Tipsy, doing events like this, and that they can help get our sake out to more people. It's just been a wonderful collaboration these past few years.
Thank you so much. It was amazing. And I hope everyone enjoyed.
Yeah.
And I see the hand, the mysterious hand from Rick. Well, thank you again. And at Tipsy, we try to have a monthly event. So please check it out, your emails, and you will get the information always. So thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Arigato. Yeah, kanpai, everyone. Kanpai. Arigato gozaimasu. Thank you. Arigato gozaimasu. Kanpai. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye, Mimi. Thank you.
Bye, Timothy. All right. Closing the event. Bye bye. Good night.